So, Yousef, we're obviously talking about a situation in the Syrian conflict, which is changing on a daily basis, is incredibly complicated, has many cross currents. We saw some of that this week with the Turkish downing of a Russian plane. But let's for a moment step back and talk about the U.S. perspective and this notion, and I should say probably the West perspective, and this notion of the way that they fight terror or the counter-terror strategy that's been adopted. You use the analogy of a boiling pot. Tell us about that analogy and what it means in real terms.
Sure. Well, when you talk about the objective of trying to defeat terrorism, there's really a couple different ways to go about it. The boiling pot analogy is the one that I found to be the most helpful. So imagine yourself being confronted with the challenge of standing above a boiling pot of water and having to prevent any bubbles from getting to the surface. You can try to do this essentially by playing defense, attempting to attack each individual bubble before it hits the surface, or even hoping to disrupt the bubbles at their earliest stage of formation. But as the heat continues to stay on, the bubbles are going to continue to grow in number, and your ability to keep up with all of them is finite. So there is going to come a time when a bubble gets through and gets to the surface, and of course we know that when terrorism comes to the surface, the costs are far greater than a simple bubble bursting. As we saw in Paris, as we saw really around the world in the last several weeks on display because of the horrific acts of ISIS. So the other way to try to deal with this challenge is to find a way to turn down the heat, essentially deal with the conditions that is allowing terrorism to fester and grow. Obviously one has to harden their defenses, have important intelligence to disrupt plots before they occur. But at the same time, that cannot be the only approach. And unfortunately, I think too often it's been the case that instead of really practicing both approaches, we have largely seen Western states, and particularly the United States, use the first approach, the defensive approach, but on the other approach actually contribute in a very dangerous way to more conditions that further and develop terrorism than actually resolving those conditions, with really the clearest and most costly example being the invasion of Iraq in 2003 and the dismantlement of the Iraqi state, the costs of which are on full display today around the world, since ISIS has been part of what has filled that vacuum.
And I certainly agree with that that sense in terms of our invasion of Iraq, and I think it's been grossly understated, the implications of that invasion in regards to ISIS. What other things though? Obviously we cannot go back, right, and uninvade Iraq. I wonder what other things, too, are driving that, because I think operationally it seems to me, and in terms of perhaps on some way in terms of like a in terms of a cause, one could argue that the Iraq invasion created ISIS. I mean, certainly it gave a lot of it put a lot of former Ba'athist Sunni generals with no means in which to regain any power or, frankly, autonomy in Iraq. I mean, what other things contribute to that? What other things are the heat in that analogy?
Well, there's a couple things, but let's just take one step back, because I want to make a distinction here. When we're talking about dealing with these conditions, we often hear about the root causes of terrorism. And I want to be clear about one thing. When we talk about ISIS, dealing with the root causes that are allowing this group to do what they do is in no way accommodating the demands that they have. ISIS is not based on legitimate grievances. One can look at various other groups, separatist groups, nationalist groups, which have engaged in terrorism that do have some legitimate grievances, even though they use illegitimate tactics, where accommodation can be part of the process of resolving the root causes and the conditions that bring them forward. The root causes that have really helped ISIS grow are a couple of different things. One, the territorial vacuum that exists because of the Syrian civil war and what is essentially a civil war in Iraq, though not as hot in Syria. And also the disenfranchisement of Syrian and Iraqi, especially Iraqi Sunnis, in the Iraqi political system that emerged in the aftermath of the invasion. And a lot of those incentives are really shaped by one of the other byproducts of this invasion of 2003, which was this regional Saudi-Iranian contest that that the war essentially kicked off. And so, you know, you have people who are very sympathetic to the, Sunni Arabs in Iraq and in Syria, who view Iran as the ultimate evil, far more evil than ISIS, and are willing to support or turn a blind eye toward radical Sunni Islamist groups like ISIS and others, so long as they act in a way that that takes away from Iran or hurts Iran in any way. So this regional contest is part of the problem that's driving the conditions on the ground, both in Syria and in Iraq, where ISIS has been able to take hold.
All right. Well, we got to take a break. When we come back, let's now that we've sort of set that table and we have this notion of both sort of the almost the operational on the ground enablement, if you will, of ISIS, and then the enablement that comes with the broader conflict, where we're talking about surrogates to fight this sort of, I guess, the surrogate war in some regards between the Saudis and the Iranians. We will take a quick break and we'll be right back with more with Yousef Munayyer. So, Yousef, before the break, you were basically outlining for us three important things that we need to restate before we go further. One, you perceive ISIS as being somewhat, not totally, but somewhat unique in terms of they're really lacking any legitimate fundamental claim that could be in any way negotiated with or part of a settlement. If I hear you correctly, ISIS simply needs to be defeated, period. Secondly, they are enabled operationally because of, to a large extent, because of our invasion of Iraq, leaving a certain amount of disaffected Sunni generals, a vast swath of ungovernable and ungoverned territory, which we should say includes a lot of resources which can fuel their fight. And the second sort of enabling factor is this ongoing proxy war, this, Cold War, but perhaps it's a little warmer than that between the Saudis and the Iranians, where some very bad people are funded to carry out their agendas. So with all that said, and you gave us that analogy of the boiling pot, instead of you hitting the water bubbles, you need to turn down that heat. How does the U.S. at this point, and how does the West, broadly speaking, how do they turn that heat down?
Well, let me just say this. What needs to be done is not going to be as difficult as actually doing what needs to be done. What needs to be done is that there needs to be a restoration of some sort of broader political order in the region, the kind of political order that existed prior to the invasion even if not along the same exact constellation. But nonetheless, one in which the major players in the region really understand where the limits of the other's influence is and can and will be for the foreseeable future. The invasion essentially opened up a huge swath of territory for contest to basically reshape that order. And what we're seeing now is that fight for the new order happening between the Iranians and the Saudis. So I think one very important thing that the Americans can do is start working to bring the Saudis and the Iranians together towards sharing a cooperative and coordinated vision for regional security. Right now, they view the region as a zero-sum game. That's something that has to fundamentally change if the major conflicts in the region are going to be brought to a close. I think there are some signs that that's beginning to happen with the conference that we recently saw in Vienna that brought the Iranians to the table on the Syria issue, and other things taking place around the globe in the form of bilateral meetings and other things as well that suggest that the parties have started to understand that continued confrontation is not in either party's interest.
What is the basis of that? Is it simply a Sunni-Shia divide, or is there some geopolitical, concerns that they have? Is it we want access to the Straits of Hormuz? I mean, what forms the basis of this rivalry that is not just a question of a rivalry? It seems to be sort of mutual fear.
Yeah, there's a great degree of fear, but it's important to keep in mind that both of these players are significant players in the region, and both of them recognize that. So, while there is a lot of sectarianism that has kind of grown out of the uptick in conflict between both of them since the war, it is less a driver of that competition than it is a byproduct of that competition. Mm-hmm. I think for each player, there's really different reasons why they dislike the other. The Iranians are a huge state. They're the center of Shiism in the region. They're going to have influence throughout the region, and they're going to have relationships with Shia populations in Arab countries. That's something that we, I think, need to accept is always going to stay that way. What is so threatening to the Saudis is not simply, Iran's geopolitical ambitions in the region, but also the model that they present in the region as well for a form of governance. And the Saudis, of course, have a monarchical form of governance where the legitimacy of the leadership is based on heredity and religion. There are other models in the region, for example, the Turks and other Muslim Brotherhood-like actors, which are Sunni states, but they derive legitimacy in part from religion, but also in large part from the ballot box. And that, too, is a threat to the Saudi model. The Iranians have a completely different model. So a lot of Saudi fear is rooted in insecurity about their own internal regime stability. It's something that drives them to be very concerned about regional dynamics and what ideas are growing out there that could challenge that form of government.
And it's very helpful for them to have not only is there value, at least there from their perception, in fighting that Shia power, but it also is helpful for them to have a foil that people can turn their attention to. All right, we just have about a minute left, Yousef. So once that is, and again, easier to do or to say, I guess, than to do.
Absolutely.
But once those two parties are brought together and calm some stasis is found that is agreeable. What is the second part? It's essentially going in and trying to stabilize Syria under the same sort of auspices?
Right. Well, if you can get that to happen, a lot of things that are not possible today become possible, and then solving the problem is a lot easier. Look, ISIS is not the Third Reich. You know, they might have very evil ideas like them, but they're not this massive military-industrialized state. They're a quasi-state actor that is, you know, facing a combined coalition of 70% of the world's military budgets, okay? This is not something that cannot be defeated. It can be defeated very easily. But you have to have a ground component that can take and hold the territory with legitimacy to ensure that the military force that's going to be used is not going to be used in a waste and just create yet another vacuum where several years from now, son of ISIS grows and becomes an even bigger problem. The key is really solving the political problem so that you can reestablish sovereign, legitimate control over the territory where ISIS is. Short of that, you can drop bombs. People might die in the process, but little is going to change in terms of the situation on the ground, and that's really what's key here in defeating this terrorist group.
Yousef Munayyer, writing in The Nation magazine, thank you so much for your time today. Fascinating stuff.
Pleasure.